internal efficiency. Now, there are different methods we use in measuring internal efficiency. What are these methods? One, we use the cohort analysis method. In the cohort analysis method, there are three ways you can use the cohort analysis method. You have the true cohort analysis method, and you have the apparent cohort, and you have the reconstructed cohort. What are the differences in this cohort analysis? When you are using the true cohort analysis, it means you are taking a particular cohort coming into the school system in a particular year, a school year, and you walk through with those students, seeing how they are passing through the student academically, those that are repeat, those that are dropping out, and so on. But in most cases, it's always difficult to have accurate record because this is a longitudinal kind of research that you're going to carry out because you're going to walk through them for a period of years. And most times it's difficult, it is expensive for you to accomplish this. Now, the next one is the apparent cohort method. The apparent cohort method is used when you do not have the data for repeaters. That is when you use the apparent cohort method. Actually, this method is not to be used whereby automatic promotion is being used. You can't use this method because what this method entails is that it's either you are promoted or you drop out. But we know that in the true sense of it, there will always be repeaters. There will be some that will repeat. But whereby you are using automatic promotion, you can't use this method. The third one is the reconstructed cohort method. The reconstructed cohort method is used whereby you know you do not have access or time to walk through the true cohort analysis. So in this case, you fall back to already existing data. You go to the school, you collect the data to know through the cohort, if you have data for two academic sections, to know how many students are in a particular grade and how many students were promoted from that grade to the next grade and how many repeated and how many drop out. Then you now apply the rates that you're going to get onto 1,000. That is how you do reconstructed cohort. Now the last one that you could use when measuring internal efficiency is the standard progression method. We will discuss more of this in the next video. Now let's see how the cohort method analysis work. Now let's have, there are assumptions behind the use of cohort reconstruction model. Whereby you are not using the true cohort, you want to use the cohort reconstruction model. So what are these assumptions? One, pupil students are enrolled in a given grade class in a certain year. So they must come in at the same time in a certain year. Secondly, there could be only three eventualities. What are these three eventualities? It's either the students are promoted or they are repeating or they drop out. Those are the three eventualities that will happen to any student in that particular cohort. Then the next one, there will be no new entrant in any of the subsequent year. There will be no new other entrant to join these cohorts. Once these cohorts take off, they will go through. No other entrant, no other people will join them in any of the grades. So you work with the cohort alone. Then the next one is that the number of times the people is allowed to repeat must be well stated. In every country, in every educational system, there is a mandate, there is a law that dictates the number of years that is allowed for the student year period. Now, in the university, if you are reading a four-year course, for example, you could be allowed the maximum of 6 years, and whereby you are not able to get through within that 6 years, they will say, okay, you are dropping out. In the primary school, let's look at it. The normal number of years you need to spend there is 6 years. Especially in Nigeria, we have 6 years of primary school. But there will be law that will state the number of years, the maximum number of years a student could stay in the school. So we need to know how many times a student is allowed to repeat for you to work it out. Now we have the flow rates for all grades remain unchanged because for you to do this, that will be the flow rate. The flow rate are the percentages at which the students are being promoted, the students are repeating, or the students are dropping out. And what happened to the flow rate? Hypothetically, at every given grade, the rates or repetition or dropout, regardless the acceptance number of repetition, are made constant. So once this is done, then you are set to class. So what do we do next is, let's get this out. We need to know the rates. What are the rates? What are the rates for promotion? Now, this is the rate that is being given for this particular data. These are the rates. So how were these rates obtained? Let's see how these rates were obtained. First, let's see how the rate for promotion was obtained. To get the rates of promotion, we are looking at this place now. Promotion from grade 1 to grade 2 in 2016-2017. So from movement from 140,204, were those that were enrolled in grade 1 in 2015-2016. Now coming to grade 2, we are having 120,500. But again, on that same year, we are told 5,000 repeated. What this simply means is that at this level, it is not all of them that there were repeaters. Now, if you come to the grade 1, where we are coming from, you look at it again. In 2016-2017, the new entrant into grade 1, here we are seeing 145,500. Again, it is not all of them that are new entrants. Out of this 145,500, we are told 15,000 of them are repeating from this 140,204. So when you are to calculate the promotion rate, right, you will need to look at how many repeated from grade 1, how many repeated from grade 2, how many repeated and drop out, and so on to grade 6. So coming to grade 1, let's cite example with this. You have 120,500. That is, this 120,500, that is this number that is promoted. You could see it, 120,500 minus 5,000. Where did you get this 5,000? This is this 5,000, because these are the numbers that are repeating from here. So when you get it out, over 140,204, the total number that were in grade 1 in the previous year. And when you divide, it's going to give you 82.4%. That is how we arrive at this 82.4%. So you can work out the next one too. If you work out this, that is from grade 2 to grade 3. Now, what do you do? To be 100,202 minus 2,000 over 119,202, you will get this 282.4% also. That is how you walk through and get. When you get to the last one, which is grade 6, what do? You are now going to look at the total number that graduated, which means these people graduated in record time. These are the number out of 140,206 that started that cohort. Only 44,860 that graduated out of 140. So what do? That will be 144,860 over this total, because this was the total that was now left out of which these people came out. So you discover that you have 78,900. And when you divide that, is how you arrive at 56.9%. Because right here, you remember it from here now, some have repeated, 1,200 repeated, and 44,860 graduated. So with this, you see that you'll be able to, we don't know how many dropouts, it means others dropout, because if you add this to this, it won't give you this. So they have a lot of a dropout. So this is how you attain this. Now, how do you get for the next one, the repetition rate? How do you calculate the rate? To calculate the repetition rate, what do? You go the same way. Right here, you have 15,000 over 140,204, and that is what, these are the repetition rates, 15, and this is 140,200. So when you divide, it will give you 10.7%. That is how we arrive at this. Now, if you are to calculate for grade 6, what do? Remember, 120 repeated over 78,900, and that will give you 1.5. Now, how do you calculate for the dropout? To get the dropout rate, add both the promotion and the repetition, and subtract from 100, because the maximum is 100. So remember, we have 82.4, that is from here, and we have those that are repeating is 10.7. when you sum them up, it gives you 93.1. so 100 minus 93.1 will give you 6.9%. this is how you arrive at this rate, and it is this rate we are now going to apply to 1,000. That 1,000 is hypothetical 1,000, but we'll be applying this rate, because these rates are generated from the actual figure of two sections, and we're going to work with them. So let's see, I'm going to move this particular table now to the next. This is this table. These are the rates we have created. Now you start with your cohort creation. Now we are talking about 2,000 to 2009. That is what we are looking through this number of years. And we start with 1,000 because it's reconstructed. So out of these 1,000, how many were promoted? To get the total number of promoted, come here, take 82.4% of this. 82.4% of this will give you this total number that is promoted. Then you take repetition, 10.7% of 1,000. The 10.7% of 1,000 will give you 107 repeating. Then you now have 6.9% of 1,000 will give you 69. That is what this arrow indicates. You see this arrow going up, that shows you dropout. This one moving this way show you promotion, and this one coming down show you repetition. So all you now need to do is to begin to apply this rate. So when you get to this level, because the total number promoted here now is 824. So in grade 2, you apply the level again. The rate again. You have 82.4%. So you take 82.4% of this. That will give you 679. So you apply the rate and construct. At the end, how many now eventually pass or fail? You know, these are the graduates. Out of 490 here, 204 dropout, 7 repeated, and 279 graduated. So at the end, when you have finished constructing the table, what do you now need to do? You sum this. 1,000 plus 107 plus 12 will give you 119. And 224 plus 123 plus 15 will give you this. That is how you sum them up. So you now move them in there to calculate the PPU year. You take grade by grade. Grade 1, you see 1,119. Then the other one, grade 2, 962. That is what you have. 808. You sum it up. At the end, if you sum it up, it's going to give you 5,161. Remember, we have not touched this. You see, this is where we stop, which is grade 6. That is 670. That is 670. So it means what we have, we now take the total output. What is the total output? These are the total that graduated successfully. That is the output. This total that graduated successfully. So that is 382. So for us to get the year input per student, we are looking at the year input per student, or the PPU year, it would be 5,161 divided by 382. That will give us 13.5. What does this mean? Instead of spending 6 years, you know, the average, it means the last student that graduated spent 13.5 years. That is what the student spent. That is 13 years, 5 months. Now, the next thing we need to calculate now is to look at how we can use it to calculate the wastage ratio. And in calculating the wastage ratio, there are two things you need to consider: the ideal input-output ratio and the actual input-output ratio. Now, here you have the ideal input-output ratio, that is normal PPU year over a unit of PPU. Now, what is the normal PPU year? The actual input-output ratio in the PPU years over successful graduates. Now, let's see how we work that out. Using this above example, we are saying actual input-output ratio, it will be what now? Remember, we have our PPU year and the actual those are actually graduated, and those actually graduated were 382. Remember, we had 13.5 there. That is what you see here now. Now, this implies that it cost a student in the cohort 13.5 years on the average to go through a secondary school instead of 6 years. So it means the last person would have spent 13.5 years instead of 6 years. Now, you come up, the ideal is what? It means each student, 6 over 1, this implies that each student is supposed to have spent 6 years to complete the school system. But here, it didn't work out that way. It was something different. Now, how do you calculate the wastage ratio? To calculate the wastage ratio, actual input-output ratio over ideal input-output ratio. So that is what we're going to do here. Now, this will give us, what is the actual input-output ratio? It was 13.5. The ideal input-output ratio is 6.0, 6 years. So if you divide this with this, I will give you 2.25. Now, what will that imply? That is a wastage that is there. And it means you have spent much above. Now, if you look at the internal efficiency, the value of wastage ratio is used to determine the internal efficiency, because this is the wastage we have now. So for us to determine the internal efficiency, what is it? We are using this ratio now. This is the ratio we are going to use to determine the internal efficiency. So how are we going to use it? Here, if it is 1, it's a perfect ratio. It means there is no wastage. And if it is less than 1, it means there is an error, because 1 is perfect, must not be less than 1. Then if it's greater than 1, it indicates the degree of inefficiency. So right here now we are having 2.25. So look at it very well. You see that the rate of the degree of inefficiency is very high, because the ideal is 1.0, and now you are having 2.25. That is an excess of 1.25. So in this case, this is to say that 1.25, 125% additional input were put to use to see 1 ppu through. You see, instead of you to spend 100%, you have spent, let's say, extra 125% or 225% against 100% you would have spent. So there is a lot of